Hello and welcome to SaltWire today for Monday, December 19th. I'm your host, Kate Walker. Canada is imposing a ban on the manufacturing and import of single-use plastics starting tomorrow. The new rules cover plastic checkout bags, cutlery, stir sticks, and certain hard-to-recycle food containers. Single-use plastic straws will also be eliminated, with some exceptions.
I think we're going that way anyways. We're trying to save the environment, and financially, it may help the people here.
I have a son and a daughter-in-law that are both environmentalists, and they live in Australia, and they're very, very up on all the environmental issues. So they're on us all the time when they come to visit.
Well, I think it's great. They're a pain in the butt. It's everything's got that plastic stuff, and I'm not a young man. I can't wait that long to tear something open with all that plastic on.
It will be a slow phase-out process. Businesses have until December 2023 to use up their remaining inventory. The manufacturing and importing of six-pack plastic rings for drink containers will be banned in June 2023, with their sale ending a year after that. The federal government's target is zero plastic waste by 2030. Canada is among the most wasteful countries in the world. World Bank data on municipal solid waste show that, on average, every Canadian throws out 706 kilograms of garbage each year. Nova Scotia banned single-use plastic bags in October of 2020. The Houston government is investing $8 million in hopes of increasing housing options for post-secondary students. It was announced today the money will be to help maintain student residences and increase student housing options and ease pressure on the housing supply. The Atlantic School of Theology here in Halifax will receive $3 million. Work there includes repairs to the brickwork, new plumbing, Wi-Fi system updates, and upgrades to the shared kitchen and bathroom facilities. There will also be 32 new beds. The provincial government will also be allocating $5 million to the new Tartan Downs housing project in Sydney, a mixed-use development that will include student housing. A new Rolling Stones exhibit has made its way to Halifax. The unzipped traveling museum exhibit of the Stones reached its final destination here over the weekend in Bears Lake. It's housed inside the steel wheels on Otter Lake Court. The exhibit takes fans back in time to the beginning of it all in Edith Grove. With no existing photos of the interior of the flat in Chelsea, England, where the English rock band stayed after they played their first gig in July 1962, a recreation was based on the memories of Keith Richards, Mick Jagger, and Charlie Watts. The recreation of Edith Grove is just a small sliver of the band's 60-year history that's on display at the exhibit. People who attend the show will be able to look at some of the instruments the musicians played and the outfits they wore on stage. Tickets range in price from $38 to $80. Unzipped will be in Halifax for 3 months until March 19th before it returns to its home base in London, England. 3 months later, the cleanup of post-tropical storm Fiona continues in some parts of the Maritimes. Several downed trees in Truro's Victoria Park require special planning and techniques to be removed following the storm. SaltWire's Chelsea Gold has the details.
3 months since tropical storm Fiona, there is a lot of damage to still clean up in Truro's Victoria Park, and it requires professional help.
Takes somebody who's familiar with cutting trees and cutting wood and using a chainsaw, but also someone who's familiar with hanging off ropes and rappelling off ropes, because we needed to use rope access methods to actually get to the tree, because the cliffs are so steep that you can't walk on it unaided.
It's a careful process for the arborist to safely make cuts while ensuring that lifelines aren't compromised while navigating along eroding soil.
Jesse and I are on the slopes rappelling, and then it takes a crew of 2 to 3 people at the bottom to limb the trees that come down with the winch, buck them into log lengths, and then move those logs to a landing area. And then we have the help of park staff and their winch to actually winch the trees down, and someone to run that winch as well. The trees are in a state that we don't often see, so they're uprooted, laying across slopes. There's trees on trees. There's trees on trees on root plates. There's root plates on trees. There's rocks. There's boulders that fall down the cliff.
Trees are being removed for the public's safety, And what's not safe are unexpected visitors.
Everybody dearly loves this park, and I'm sure everybody misses being in it. But the thing for us is we have a lot of factors at play here, and one factor we don't need is worrying about someone wandering into the work site and something happening with them.
Right now, they are focused on the steep slope behind Holy Well Gazebo.
This is one of the worst areas where we're at now, so if we can get through that, it does get easier to clean up what's left. We will be doing something with Jacob's Ladder. It will definitely be left to the last, I would say, because we do believe that it'll be easier to be cleaned up.
I'm Chelsea Gould in Truro, Nova Scotia for the SaltWire Network.
It's time now for a glimpse of today's Thinking Out Loud with Sheldon McLeod. Today, Sheldon is speaking with Allison Alley of Compassion Canada about global food insecurity.
Shouldn't we look after the people in our own backyard before we start looking to other places around the globe to help?
Yeah, and what I would say to them is absolutely, you should be looking to, caring for, engaged in the needs of your neighbors around the world. And as an organization, what we would recognize is we are uniquely, I would say, called and have unique skill sets and experience and capabilities in the international scene. It's a unique way in which we operate in international development, unique challenges, unique opportunities to be able to deal with the multifaceted realities of poverty and injustice there. And again, when you have decades of experience in that, we continue to give ourselves to that cause. And yet, we absolutely, we're child advocates as an organization. I'm a mom of two, I was going to say young girls, Sheldon, maybe they're not so young anymore, they're growing up, but we really care about advocating for the needs of all children and really being a part of opening up people's, you know, minds, hearts, hands, their habits to be able to care for those in need.
And for Sheldon's full conversation, head to the opinion section of saltwire.com. Time now for the Atlantic Sports Wire, presented by Scott Squires.
Ellen Lawrence is a forward with the St. Mary's University Huskies women's hockey team. Ellen, you're one of the veteran leaders on this team. What does that role mean to you?
I would say it means a lot of like leadership roles. In the past, I haven't really said anything in the room or made my presence known, but I've find myself making that more of a statement this year and making sure I have my own opinions out there and trying to be a leader just to the younger ones. Even though we are an older team, we still have quite a few rookies this year, and I'm just trying to give someone a figure for them to look up to.
You're on that break now. The winter semester starts early in the new year. What are going to be a couple of keys for this team to have success into that winter semester toward the playoffs?
I think we just need to remember what we did well in the first half, especially ending off in that last game and the couple games that we had had before that. Remembering the little details and just remembering why we're here, to have fun and to win. And I think that if we remember those things, then we'll be successful this year.
In Halifax, I'm Scott Squires for the Atlantic Sports Wire.
First star. Number 20, Ellen Lawrence. So I think.
Thank you, Scott. On to weather now to see what's coming up in the forecast. We're going to check in now with our weather specialist, Alistair Alders.
Thanks, Kate. Well, it was another damp and dreary day here in Halifax, and we had scattered showers around as well. Some wet flurries and lighter snow, especially further inland. Now, there is a bit of good news in the upcoming forecast. There is a bit of sunshine to talk about, but some bad news, too. There is a storm on the way for Christmas Eve. This evening, we will have rain showers or flurries. Now, those flurries more likely inland and over higher terrain. The temperature this evening near +1. We will have northwest winds of 20 to 40 kilometers per hour. They do increase on Tuesday morning. Northerly winds of 30 to 60 kilometers per hour. And we'll continue to have rain showers or flurries. And we'll start the day near 2 degrees. Into the afternoon, a chance of showers with the high heading up to 3 degrees. And northerly winds still gusting 30 up to 50 kilometers per hour. in the afternoon. Now, a ridge of high pressure is on the way. I do think Wednesday will be mainly cloudy, but Thursday looking pretty good right now with a mix of sun and clouds, certainly the pick of the upcoming week. There is a large storm that will be developing over the Midwestern U.S. into the Great Lakes region. Those associated weather fronts with that storm, a warm and cold front, will be moving through our region as we go through Friday and Christmas Eve, set to bring some heavy rain and intense winds here to Halifax. Now, specifics still to be determined, but certainly we could be seeing winds that approach or even exceed 90 kilometers per hour. So it's a storm we will want to watch, especially if you are traveling into the upcoming weekend ahead of Christmas. Kate.
Thank you, Alistair. That's all for now. For more extended video and full online articles, stay tuned to saltwire.com. And you can find us on Instagram and Twitter at Saltwire Today. I'm your host, Kate Walker. Thank you for joining us, and we'll see you back here tomorrow.